Hello, everybody. I want to thank everybody for coming to the first annual Portland Atheist Festival. Thank you, everybody, for coming. My name's Charlie Ringo, and I'm one of the organizers together with Karen Garst. And we had this idea of having an atheist festival to help promote the idea that it's okay to not believe in God, that you can still be an ethical, moral, patriotic person and not believe in some fire and brimstone character of the Old Testament or even another religion or another religion. And there's so many reasons that, there's so many reasons to not believe in God. Our point here isn't really to attack religion, it's to promote non-belief as a socially acceptable thing so that people feel comfortable telling their parents, telling their friends, telling their neighbors, you know, I really don't believe in that stuff. I just don't believe in that stuff, and I don't have to believe it to be a good person. So that's the point of this festival, is to celebrate life without having a belief in some supernatural power. And I hope everybody has a good time. We have a lot of informational booths. I will invite people to come up and just give a two-minute speech. One of the rules that Karen and I came up with was no long speeches. We weren't going to have that. We'd rather have popcorn than speeches. But thanks again for attending, and I hope everybody has a good time.
Hi, my name is Karen Garst, and I'm the co-organizer of this festival. Thank you all for coming out. We really appreciate it. Woo! And I got involved. I was raised as a Lutheran in Bismarck, North Dakota. And then in the 90s, I read a lot of the books about the Jesus Seminar and looked at the culture and looked at the history and said, this is made up. The Bible is written by men. And in particular, it's written by men. Because if you look at how almost all religions treat women, they subjugate them. And then in 2014, the United States Supreme Court issued a decision in Burwell versus Hobby Lobby. And it said because this company, Hobby Lobby, had religious views, it did not have to provide certain forms of birth control to its employees under Obamacare. And I said, that's enough. We fought for this in the 60s. And so I got 22 women together who have written essays, their personal stories of leaving religion, and some of them are very sad. And the book is called Women Beyond Belief, Discovering Life Without Religion. It's available for pre-order on Amazon. And if you're interested in some of my other writings, I'm called The Faithless Feminist and have a blog. Every 2 weeks I put out something about women and religion, and I hope you'll take a look at it. And then finally, in my era of self-promotion here, I have a YouTube channel, and I've done a presentation called From Goddess to God, and it shows how monotheism eliminated the feminine divine, which is another reason women should really, really question this religion. And I'm just delighted you're here, and I will be happy to answer any questions.
Hi, my name is Laurel Hines, and I have my atheist t-shirt on, and I came up from Salem. And I was born a Lutheran. Oh, I should mention I'm a retired mental health therapist. And I was born to a Lutheran, and I was Lutheran when I was younger. And I started out believing in God and considering myself a Christian. In fact, I used to wear a Christian necklace. And I began to question a lot of the things in the Bible and how people go to church and would recite things like the Lord's Prayer and they would never think about what they were saying. They would just automatically say it without much seeming to have much thought about it. And I began asking our minister about some of the really weird things that were in the Bible, some of the things about killing and especially the Old Testament, but a lot of the things about concubines and killing and things like that. And the minister just said, you think too much. So when I went to college, I began to think about it even more, and it made even less sense to me. And I took a religions course, and the more I learned about it, the less sense the Bible made to me. And so I tried to find another religion that I could believe in, but nothing seemed to make any sense when I thought about it very much. And so eventually, I started to believe that maybe God was just energy. And that seemed to appease me for a while, but then that didn't make any sense either. The more I learned about science, and I'm kind of avidly into reading about the brain and science. And anyway, I read the book, Fighting God by Steven Silverman, and I realized I have to come out of the closet and let people know that atheists are good people and that they're not evil. So I hope that all of us atheists come out of the closet. Non-believers rock. Thank you.
My name's Ashlyn, and I just wanted to say that the Bible isn't real, and it's been proven wrong from science many times, over and over again, and they still try to argue it, but that's okay. I'm in recovery, and I can honestly say you don't have to have a higher power to get clean and sober, and you don't have to have a higher power to vote. All right.
Hi there, I'm Steve Jacobs. I have a prepared speech. Everyone needs to come to grips with life and death in their own way. Just like everyone else, I've had to find a way to deal with the fears that accompany the prospect of death, the question of life's meaning, and uncertainty about the future. When times are bad, I need some basis for hope for a better future. The simplest solution to such problems is to adopt a religion. Some people are indoctrinated into a religion as children. The more fortunate are given the freedom to engage in a self-honest search for truth. Whatever the results of that search, they end up, in the end, they are likely to be happier than those who are indoctrinated. But what is truth? Is it simply what dampens those anxieties and fears? Does reality conform to our desires? When people answer no to those questions, they engage in a different kind of search for truth, one that requires a model of reality that, while perhaps a bit frightening, are more satisfying because they don't require the acceptance of ideas that contradict real experience. Such a search will not accept virgins' births and resurrections as having credibility. I was given the freedom to find my own way, and it is my nature to search for truth in this manner. That search leads to an appreciation of science and scientific knowledge, which for me led to a naturalistic view in which supernatural beings or forces make no sense whatsoever. It is not a dogmatic belief, but rather an idea I deem most likely based upon all evidence. But how do I live with its less satisfying implications for my mortality and meaning? Where do I find hope? My mortality fuels my appreciation for the value of life and my desire to get the most out of it. I feel I give meaning to my life by working to fulfill my own potential and doing what I can to make life better for everyone. While human beings are capable of doing terrible things, I find hope in the evidence of intelligence, love, and compassion exhibited by many people. I also find hope in the scientific community, which is searching for truth about the natural world, and in doing so is giving us the opportunity to create a better future for everyone. The path to a better life and new possibilities is paved by understanding the natural world, not the mind of any god. About 20 years ago, I found that there is a name for a naturalistic perspective that values evidence-based belief, reason, and the well-being of both humanity and each individual human being. That name is humanism.
Good morning. Hi, everybody. So my name is Robin Stafford. I moved up into the Portland area. I'm actually in Vancouver. About a year ago, I came from Georgia by way of Japan, by way of Georgia again, and I'm from Texas. So one of your lone Southern Baptist grown-up girls here. And when I was in my early 20s, I learned about how Christianity absorbed a lot of the traditions of the old religions in Europe. And when I researched that, I was like, oh my gosh, so Christmas and some of the Easter traditions are actually pagan. So I researched more, found out how the Bible was put together, and I thought, you know what? I really like these holidays, and I think that divinity is more than what's in a book. So I became a pagan and was a pagan for over 10 years. And through that time, I went to college, went back to college, had some pagan friends, did some nice things looking for spirits and trees and all that fun wooey stuff. And then I had a car wreck coming back from an art show, that I went to at my university, and I should not have walked away from it. Normally, when people come away from wrecks that they should have died in, they find religion. Not me. Not me. So I found that there was peace and that I needed to do things in my life and connect to people. And I needed to just put away everything else. And so daily life, people to people, person to person, connection. That's my goal with my life. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Sandra, and I assume I'm supposed to be talking about why I'm an atheist. I am, because when I went to church, I had to be bribed to go to church. All the children did. We held out for candy. And it was patently illogical to me, whatever they said. And then they yelled at you and told you you had to be good, and then they defined good. By that time, you're very annoyed, and then they wanted money for it. So it made no sense to me to get up in the morning and go down where someone comes close to calling you names, tells you you're gonna burn in hell, and then expects money from you. Even as a child, I thought it was a farce. All my sisters and brothers, with the exception of one, came to the same conclusion. We were bribed until we went through the confirmation process for Protestants, and then we could not go, and no one went. They all turned out to be atheists separately and individually and independently. So that's how I came to that conclusion. I came to that conclusion when I was probably around 8. My sister said she came to that conclusion when she was 6. The other said, I never believed any of that. That was just a whole bunch of fairy tales. So that's how I became an atheist, is just naturally. It was kind of like your feet getting bigger. Okay, that's it.
Okay. Hi, I'm Carolyn Tomei. I am a recovering politician. I was thinking about this and preparing about what I was going to say, and I'm going to be short. When I was sworn in to be mayor of Milwaukee, I was offered a Bible to swear on to protect and uphold the Constitution. I didn't use that. That was probably the first sign that I was not a theist. After that, then, I was in the legislature, and every day we started with a prayer, and we also said the Pledge of Allegiance. Well, the Pledge of Allegiance, I said that when I was in school as a kid, but I couldn't figure out why they were making it different. What were they saying? And I realized it was under God. So I couldn't say that, so I said under love. And later on in my 14 years in the legislature, I was opening up the formal session of the legislature for that year. So I was presiding officer at that opening of the legislature. And so again, we had to say the Pledge of Allegiance. And I said, as I had been saying for a dozen years, under love. And that seems pretty benign, don't you think? Pretty nice, under love, we are here doing our thing. I got a lot of people who were very, very, very upset at that, including people across the country. So I guess what I'm saying is, I'm here coming out. I have gay friends who have come out. I have never come out to being an atheist, and now I'm coming out. Yay! So thank you all for coming. I hope more of you will be coming out. And I sort of wish I'd done this earlier, even though I think people picked up that I was an atheist. We always started each session with a prayer. So what I did was, instead of opening with the prayer, I would have musicians, poets, artists, actors coming and start instead of a prayer. So I changed that sort of expectation that every floor session would start with the prayer. It's the, now they would call, when the poets would come up to make their presentation, there would be a whisper among my colleagues, here come the Tomatheists.
Well, hi, my name's Brian Hines. I'm come all the way from Salem. Hi, Karen Garst was so shameless about plugging her book and her blog. I'll plug mine. I got a Church of the Churchless blog I started in 2004. My story, a lot of people talk about Christianity, but Eastern religions can be equally religious-y. So 1970, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll, the Beatles, Keezy, Tibetan Book of the Dead, psychedelics, meet an Indian guru, follow that person, meditate hours a day for 35 years. The dream is to experience higher regions of reality, because who doesn't want more reality? Who doesn't want more life? So rather than just this life, you can soar through other regions and your astral self and your causal self. Except after 35 years, you talk to all your friends and all the other people doing that, and it would be like the secret thing. You're not supposed to talk about your experiences, and I would give talks to the group, and I wrote a few books for the group, and then afterwards people would come up and say, thanks for saying you aren't having any of these experiences, because I'm not either. And then it turns out that nobody is having these experiences, because unlike Christianity, where you get the big goodie after death, in an Eastern meditative path, you're supposed to be experiencing God, this mystical visions and light and sound right now. And when you're not, after 35 years, you say, look, I'm actually not experiencing more reality, and I'm experiencing less, because I'm spending 2 hours of my day in a closet meditating, trying to experience, and what I'm experiencing is my own head. So every talk I would give, and this is my favorite quote in life, is from Philip K. Dick, the science fiction writer, that said, reality is that which, when you stop believing in it, doesn't go away. And what I found was, when I stopped believing in my meditation, my guru in this path, it would go away. And what we want is a life, is a reality like this reality, this natural reality, that doesn't go away just when we don't believe in it. So atheist is great, reality is great, meditation is great, but you don't need to believe, just experience. Thank you.
Hi, my name is, I'm Dave DiNucci. I'm currently the president of Humanists of Greater Portland that meets in Northwest Portland every week. And if you want to know about us, there's a table for us. I've been asked to explain why I became an atheist, but I can't really do that any more than I can explain why I see gray when I look up at the sky or whatever, why I perceive that as gray. It's just a conclusion based on my perceptions. But I can describe my path that led me to this point, so in some sense, how I became a humanist, an atheist and a humanist. I was actually born an atheist, I think most of us were. I was then introduced to Catholicism by my family. I attended church regularly. I'm not sure the church ever played the same role that it played for a lot of people. I didn't find it very fun or rewarding or a good place to socialize or any of those things. I was told that it was a good institution, and I knew some good people that were part of it, and I eventually actually became an altar boy for the church because I wanted to help out this good institution. But some of the teachings really confused me, and I think it frustrated the priest that I had no desire to take confession, and therefore I wasn't allowed to take communion according to the rules, and it's like I wasn't drinking the Kool-Aid, and that didn't really go over very well, I think. In my later teens, I stopped bothering with the church, and in college, I actually fell in love with a Japanese woman who was a Zen Buddhist, and we eventually got married in a Unitarian ceremony. And we largely lived a secular life at that point for several years. And that was fine with me. When the marriage was breaking up, though, and there were money problems and issues with other people and all kinds of issues, I was wondering, okay, how do I make this work? Let's try the things I learned in church. Let's, you know, turn the other cheek and this and that and the other thing. Just some rote rules that I had learned, and those weren't working out at all. And I said, you know, why shouldn't I just use my brain to solve these problems? I mean, I know some things about the world around me. Maybe I should just use sensible things and science and whatever. And I realized that I never really thought that prayer or God were viable solutions to problems, and it really seemed silly to rely on forces unseen with no evident, concrete evidence, when there were lots of real things there. So it was then that I realized that I was an atheist, and I was probably 35 at that point. So it's later in life, I guess. still, that alone didn't seem enough for me. I still felt motivated to help out, to facilitate human progress and thriving humanity. Atheism alone didn't capture that. I would certainly feel hypocritical to depend on religious people to handle the dirty or uncomfortable jobs and me to just, you know, say, okay, I'll just go about my atheism business. And I even if I felt their motives were misguided or whatever, if I was still depending on them, it just seemed a little bit funny to me. So I realized, as a rationalist and a scientist, that we should realize we're dependent on one another and the world around us for our own good, and we should act accordingly. So I did a little research, and I found a group that sounded like they understood this, called the humanists. The name scared me a little because it sounded kind of self-centered and stuff. It wasn't until a few years later that I actually attended my first meetings at the Humanists of Greater Portland, and I knew practically immediately that that was my tribe. I fit right in there. So now I do find these Sunday meetings fun and rewarding, and that these people are ones I like to socialize with. I learn something new about the world around me virtually every week. I have stimulating conversations. I'm involved with improving the world around me. It's just rewarding. There's no pretending, no imagining, no guilt trips, etc. It's just a place that I can go and feel like I'm in a group that's doing good things for very good reasons. So that's my story.
I can handle.
My name's Wes, and I want you to look at those guys over there. Jesus forgives, and you see their signs? They come here every day at noon, except when it's raining hard. I guess people's souls aren't quite as valuable if it's raining hard. I used to be one of them. I used to be a missionary. How many of you have heard of Multnomah? Multnomah University, Multnomah School of the Bible. I got a theology degree from Multnomah School of the Bible. And then I would come out and I'd do evangelizing like these guys. I must not have been very good. I'm not very good at standing either. So my parents, my dad was a hard drinking Navy guy, and we didn't go to church, and he got drunk, and my mother and dad yelled at each other, and they were going to get divorced. And then when I was about 13, we moved to Spokane, and a country preacher got his hands on my mother. I mean, not literally. Got her mind, and she accepted Jesus as her Savior. She quit arguing with my dad. And then 6 months later, after my dad decided it was real, he accepted Jesus too. And he stopped drinking. They stopped arguing. They stopped drinking. We started going to church 3 times a week. My brother and I and my mother and dad formed a gospel quartet. We sang on the stage of the church. And then we would go out and witness. And when I graduated from high school, I really didn't know what to do. So I came down here to Portland and went to Multnomah. And after 5 years, I finally got my degree. And then I didn't know what to do. So at the time here in Portland, even right here, there was a lot of hippie. The hippie culture and the Jesus people. And every time I'd ask somebody if they'd heard of Jesus or if they'd heard the good news, they'd say, "Yeah, I've heard it, and I don't want to hear it again. It's boring." So I thought, I got to go someplace where they haven't heard the good news so much. Strangely enough, I thought Europe would be the place. So I went to Austria as a missionary. Then I went to England. And for several years, I did missionary work. Done a lot of singing, took meetings, and preached, and so on and so forth. I wasn't a really good missionary, so I taught myself graphic design, and that's what I've done for the rest of my life. I'm semi-retired now. But the interesting thing is, about 7 years ago, I started asking myself, well, if God is love, how can he condemn people to eternity in hell? And if you talk to these people right here, these three people, four people, they'll tell you that you're a sinner and that you need to be saved from your sins. And if you don't believe in Jesus as your personal Savior, you will spend eternity being tortured. And I thought to myself, even as a Christian, I had doubts about that particular version of God. So a few years ago, about 6 or 7 years ago, I actually decided, you know, this version of God doesn't make any sense to me. I'm a parent of two boys. What would they have to do for me to condemn them to be tortured for eternity? And there's nothing they would do. So believe me, if you ever go talk to these people, they're going to tell you you were born in sin, you're a sinner, and you need to be saved. I'm telling you that most of you look like great people. You don't look like sinners. You spend most of your life and most of your waking hours being kind and generous to other people. So you don't have a sin nature. You have a human nature, and I encourage you to make the best of it without God and enjoy life and enjoy this world without having to refer to a supernatural being to give it meaning. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Bruce, and as we heard previously, I was born an atheist to a family where my mother was Catholic and my dad liked to fish. I have two older brothers and an older sister who went through the whole Catholic First Communion, stuff like that. But luckily for me, and unluckily for my mother, she had a medical condition and she kind of stopped driving because she had a thing. So since my dad went fishing on Sunday, they stopped going to church. I had only been to church a few times, mainly to play bingo. But in that way, though, I didn't really get indoctrinated. And so I got to grow up making up my own mind. And I really like science, so I found that there was an explanation for a lot of things that people were asking. If you looked closely or you just listened, you could pretty much not have to believe in the supernatural to get by in life and have a good life. I'm not coming out of the closet. I've actually been real vocal about my beliefs throughout my life, and if people want to have a debate, I'll gladly talk to them, you know, give them my side of things. But I think my basic belief is I do not believe in the supernatural. No ghosts, no fairies, whatever. Sorry. I have such a natural loud voice anyway. But I think I moved from Massachusetts, where I grew up. I moved to Boise, Idaho, into a very red state. So I was glad I was able to provide an alternative point of view for people who needed one. But now I'm in Portland, and I'm actually much happier here than I was 40 years in Boise because the weather and the fact that more free thinkers here. I don't feel so alone. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Dave Hebworth. I went to Sunday school as a child and joined the church at the age of 13 after my father died because it seemed to be the thing to do. I continued to go to church most of my life. In Easter of 2000, the pastor was talking about Pascal's Law, that it's better to believe in the end, find out you were wrong, than to not believe in the end, find out you were wrong. The pastor then asked, is life nothing more than a crapshoot? I remember thinking, yes, that's the way I look at it. I now believe that many of the stories in the Bible are simply not true. In 1 Kings chapter 11, it says that Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines, and they led him astray. Now, a religion teacher from Lewis and Clark College once said, That may have been a scribe wanting to butter up Solomon. The second chapter of Matthew talks about Herod killing all the boys under the age of two because he was afraid Jesus would grow up to overthrow him. I believe that if Herod had actually done something that horrific, killing all the boy babies under the age of two, it would have been remembered in history, but there is no mention of it except in the Bible. The stories may sort of be like the story of George Washington cutting down the cherry tree and then confessing. That story was not true. It was circulated by a preacher who wanted to build character in children. I used to sing in the church choir. If you sing words repeatedly in rehearsal and performance, you start to really think about it. Washed in the blood of the Lamb, what the heck does that mean? I thought if I just sang in a choir and kept my mouth shut, I would be okay. Then one night at the end of choir practice, I was thinking how this didn't make sense anymore. That distracted me and I wound up losing the tip of my finger in the choir room door. Does that make me an atheist martyr? I finished out the choir year and then came to the Humanists of Greater Portland. I enjoy the programs we have. We have had Karen Garst talk about From Goddess to God, the evolution of deities from female to male. We had a history professor talk about the journey of a Civil War surgeon a whole year before Mercy Street came to PBS. Last Sunday, we had a former NPR reporter talk about the sex trafficking here in Portland. This coming Sunday at the corner of 26th and Thurman, we will have a person talking about three 19th century scientists who changed the face of medicine. One principle that most religions advocate is to simply treat others the way you wish to be treated. That's the one rule I try to follow. I heard someone say that a lot of things would happen after they die. They just wouldn't be a part of it. I believe that death is simply the end of experience. When I die, my creation, my cremation is paid for and my ashes will go into somebody's garden. I just hope I don't kill any plants. If the fundamentalists are right and I am wrong, when I die, it may be the first time I've been warm since I left Arizona. If the reincarnationists are right and I am wrong, coming back as a good dog would definitely be a step up for me. Coming back as a therapy dog in a children's hospital is probably too much to ask. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jackie, and I am a part of the Women Beyond Belief book over there that's coming out in October. It's about 22 women and their stories from belief in religion to non-belief. All right. I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of my journey in general, becoming an atheist and also not believing in God. So when I was 6 or 7 years old, I imagined that somewhere in the world there was a large vault or a secret hangar that held all of life's answers and deepest mysteries. When the world needed information, a select group of people, possibly in robes or decorated uniforms, would turn to the well-oiled spindle handle and knowledge would be given out, like an epistemic trickle-down economics. I was pretty much ripe for having some religion and being indoctrinated at that point. As I grew older, I put away that notion. As I bumped into people with differences of opinion, I began a journey of philosophical discovery. Like a child on a beach, I picked through religions and beliefs like there are shells in the sand. Putting one after another to my ear, I listened for one sound that was louder than all the rest. But all of them were a few decibels quieter than I could really hear. It took a philosophy course in critical thinking to make me think and realize that what I wanted was not pre-processed answers, but a way to filter what is most likely true from what is most likely false. Through these classes, I learned to think through conclusions that I came to in life, that each piece of knowledge is connected to each other in a web. If I believe in one claim, it may alter or change others. Take homeopathy, for example. One claim is that the more you dilute a substance, the more powerful it becomes, releasing a vital energy. To believe in homeopathy, I would have to ignore what I know about the process of dilution in my everyday life. And that may be hard when it comes to thinking about sanitation and other things like that. I'm okay with changing my mind and paradigm shifts. That happens in science all the time. However, if that is going to be the case, we need immense amount of evidence and explanatory power for the ideas that are being presented. Like Carl Sagan said, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. This also leads me to the logical fallacy of the burden of proof. Proof or evidence of a legitimate claim lies with the person who is making a statement, and not upon anyone else to disprove something. Therefore, I do not consider myself an atheist because I believe there is no God, but I do not see enough evidence from others to justify the positive belief that there is one. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. First off, thanks to the band. Thanks to everybody helping out here. All the volunteers, the tabling people. My name is Bernie Daler, and just a little bit of history about me. I grew up as a Catholic. In college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. And then for some 25 years, I grew as a Christian, and in 2009, after just a couple years of getting a seminary degree, I became an atheist, because I think atheism makes the best sense of our worldview. I want to give a public thanks to a group of people that aren't here. These are called the New Atheists. Okay, thanks. Yeah, people are arguing about what's a lie or not. I want to thank the New Atheists. When I was a Christian, I remember when Richard Dawkins came out. Richard Dawkins was a scientist, and he said evolution was a fact. As a Christian, I didn't believe in evolution. And I thought, okay, well, that's fine. Who are the Christians going to put up? And for years, they couldn't put up anybody to really debate Dawkins, because on the one hand, a lot of Christians don't believe in evolution, so they're going to be silly because they're not scientific. On the other hand, they could put forward a Christian like Francis Collins that does accept evolution, but that's going to hurt the other Christians. So, you know, along with Sam Harris and all these guys, I learned something critical, which I think is scientific thinking versus magical thinking. With magical thinking, you explain things by miracles. How did humans come to be? God made humans by a miracle, poof. At one time there was no humans, and then the next day, boom, there's humans. At one day there was no whales, boom, God said, let there be, that's an incantation, and magically whales appeared. The same with tigers. One day no tigers, next day, boom, there's tigers. That's magical thinking. And thanks to scientific thinking, we can all have a brand new way of seeing life. So this is my thank you to all the new atheists and people who are making a stand for atheism, because if it wasn't for people confronting me in my Christian faith, I would still be a Christian today. I wouldn't have known any better. A lot of people are patronizing. They're saying, don't mess with the Christians because they're fine. But I would have continued to be lost if that was the case. So I'm thankful for people, smart people, that confronted me. And because of that, I feel like I'm in a better place now, because I'm living in reality instead of a delusion. So thanks.
I want to thank everybody for coming here. And I also want to introduce my good friend, State Representative Mitch Greenlick, who is brought a lot of good common sense to the state legislature, and I want everybody to give Mitch Greenlick a nice applause.
Hi, folks. I'm delighted to be here today to help represent this cause. I view myself as a part of secular Judaism, a tradition that goes back five centuries, and I'm really happy to be here to talk about the issues that are involved. I serve in the legislature, and one of the populations that I tend to serve is the secular part of our state's population, which actually is about 43% of the population of Oregon. And I'm trying to do things I can to make the laws even-handed between the secular component and the sacred component of our population. As an example, if you want to get married, you can go to an official of a religious organization, otherwise known as a clergy person, and ask them to officiate in your ceremony. But if you want to go to an official of a secular organization to perform your wedding ceremony, you can't. It's not allowed under Oregon law. For the last two sessions, I've been trying to level that playing field so that officials of secular organizations could perform marriages for their organization's members. We get pushback to that with stories like this is a way to have sham marriages that'll trick women into the sex trade and things like that. That's the kind of pushback that we get. I've been at it two sessions now. I've been able to get it out of one house first, another house first, but never both houses at the same time. We'll be at it again, and I'll be there to represent your interests. Happy to be here. Happy to be here with Charlie Ringo, who served with me in the legislature for a long time and is a great friend. Charlie, thank you for this work. This work is really important.
Thank you, man.
And that's inside 2 minutes, right?
Yes.
I'm a student at PSU. Liberal studies is my major, and I have been a non-believer basically all my life. The claims of religion have never made sense to me, and I've always wanted more, and I've wanted better answers. So I've made it my mission in life to, you know, question everything and to help other people see the benefit of doubt. And in order to do this, I work on an app together with one of my professors at PSU that encourages people to have respectful, productive conversations about faith-based beliefs, and it encourages people to doubt the claims of religion, and that is what I spend a lot of my time on, and I've helped organize this event, and I'm really grateful to be here. Thanks for listening.
Hello, I'm Marsha Abelman. I am an escaped fundamentalist. Can you hear me? Yay! The wonderful thing about being out of religion for me is that I am finally able to speak my mind as a woman. I'm not told to go to the kitchen. I don't have to do any more potluck casseroles if I don't want to. Yeah. I don't want to lead prayers anymore, but I will say that religion very much abused me in my childhood in Texas. I'm very happy to be a free thinker now, and I encourage other people to do it, not to lose their faith if they want it, but to find a way to think freely. That's pretty much it. Thanks.
I'm just going to tell a short story, and then we're going to have more music. So when my 7-year-old kid, Reese, it was late December, and my wife was putting him to bed, and he said, "Mommy, is there really a Santa Claus?" And my wife thought for a minute and said, "No, we just think it's fun to pretend. There's not really a Santa Claus." And then my kid thought about it for a minute, and he said, "Yeah, you know, it's not that hard to figure out that Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny and baby Jesus aren't real." Went right to that. Anyway.
Okay, who's heard of Robert Ingersoll? Yeah, he was a famous orator from the 1800s. So I'm going to read a very well-known speech from him. "When I became convinced that the universe is natural, that all ghosts and gods are myths, there entered into my brain, into my soul, into every drop of my blood, the sense, the feeling, the joy of freedom. The walls of my prison crumbled and fell, the dungeon was flooded with light, and all the bolts and bars and manacles became dust. I was no longer a servant, a serf, a slave. There was for me no master in all the wide world, not even in infinite space. I was free, free to think, free to express my thoughts, free to live to my own ideal, free to live for myself and those I loved, free to use all my faculties, all my senses, free to spread imagination's wings, free to investigate, to guess, and to dream and hope,
free to judge and determine for myself, free to reject all ignorant and cruel creeds, all the inspired books that savages have produced, and all the barbarous legends of the past, free from popes and priests, free from all the called and set apart, free from sanctified mistakes and holy lies, free from the fear of eternal pain, free from the winged monsters of the night, free from devils, ghosts, and gods. For the first time, I was free. There were no prohibited places in all the realms of thought, no air, no space where fancy could not spread her painted wings. No chains for my limbs, no lashes for my back, no fires for my flesh, no masters for frown or threat, no following another's steps, no need to know, to bow or cringe or crawl or utter lying words. I was free. I stood erect and fearlessly, joyously faced all worlds. And then my heart was filled with gratitude, with thankfulness, and went out in love to all the heroes, the thinkers, who gave their lives for the liberty of hand and mind and brain, for the freedom of labor and thought, to those who fell on the fierce fields of war, to those who died in dungeons bound with chains, to those who proudly mounted scaffold stairs, to those whose bones were crushed, whose flesh was scarred and torn, to those but by fire consumed, to all the wise, the good, the brave of every land, whose thoughts and deeds have given freedom to the sons of men. And then I vowed to grasp the torch that they held and hold it high, that light might conquer darkness still.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Gail, and I've been in Portland for a few years now, and I'm very happy to live in a very secular city that's very friendly towards people of non-belief. And I find for me, the word I use most in talking about the way I look at the universe since I've gotten rid of all the God stuff is clarity. I feel like you can see through a lot of the nonsense, and I find that is very freeing. And you could just kind of enjoy the material world, enjoy the one life we have, and use that to do positive things if you want, or just be alive. So I think it's a very clarifying experience not having religion, and I think it's a very freeing experience. And but at the same time, I wouldn't ban anything either. But anyway, I wish everyone well, and whatever your beliefs or non-beliefs may be. And I'm Gail. And also, oh, one more thing, I'm going to promote the book, of course. Just got to promote the book. There's a book coming out in October called Women Beyond Belief. It's a series of stories by a number of women authors about their leaving religion. And we have about three or four of the authors floating around today. And I'm one of them. I have a little memoir in there. So if you want to get it, I'm Gail. And we have cards with the information on the table over there. Thank you very much.
My name is Val Humboldt. I've known that I was an atheist for nearly 50 years now. I discovered it while I was serving as a Mormon missionary in Germany. Being born and raised a Mormon, you're taught to love the truth and to love the gospel, and that the gospel is the surest means to measure the truth. As you get older, you learn other methods of measuring the truth, science, reason, consistency, things like that. And at some point, the conflict between them bothered me enough that when it finally was resolved with my religious experience of insight, it turned out that I loved the truth more than I loved the gospel. And I have since always been an atheist. I went back to BYU, finished my degree there. I didn't run from the fact that that was my heritage, my family, but that is not my belief, and I believe that I understand the world much more clearly as an atheist than you can as a theist. As a theist, you have to take so many things on faith that in fact don't quite make sense. That's my story. I'm Val Humboldt. I just want the world to know there are those of us out here who do not believe in a supernatural being.
Hello, my name is Jackie Burgett. And I'm part of the group that has the book, Women Beyond Belief, Discovering Life Without Religion, that's coming out in October. I just wanted to say thank you, everybody, for coming, because this is really exciting to have people having dialogues and talking about their own personal beliefs. So I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of my journey from belief to non-belief. When I was around 6 or 7 years old, I imagined that somewhere in the world there was a large vault and a secret hangar that held all of life's mysteries. When the world needed information, a select group of people, possibly in robes or decorated uniforms, would turn to the well-oiled spindle handle, and knowledge would be given out, like an epistemic trickle-down economics. Suffice it to say, that's not really how it goes. And as I grew older, I basically learned by bumping into other people that there was no one way to believe in life. So I began on a journey of philosophical discovery after that. Like a child on a beach, I picked through religions and beliefs like they were seashells in the sand. Putting one after another to my ear, I listened for one sound that was louder than all the rest, but really, they were always a few decibels lower and quieter than I could actually hear. I took a philosophy course in critical thinking, and it made me realize that what I really needed was not pre-processed answers, but a way to filter what is most likely true from what is most likely false. Through these classes, I learned to think through the conclusions that I came to in life, that each piece of knowledge is connected like a vast web. If I believe one claim, it may change or alter the others. For me, I take homeopathy for an example. One claim is that the more you dilute a substance, the more powerful it becomes, releasing a vital energy. For me to believe in that, it means that I would have to ignore what I know about the process of dilution in everyday life. I'm okay with changing my mind and having different paradigm shifts, but the one thing that is really important is that they have some sort of explanatory power or large body of evidence to back them up. Like Carl Sagan says, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. This leads me to the logical fallacy of the burden of proof. The proof or evidence of a legitimate claim lies with the person who is making that statement, and it is not upon anyone else to disprove it. Therefore, I do not consider myself an atheist because I believe that there is no God, but because I do not see enough evidence from others to justify the positive belief that there is one. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Karen Garst, and I'm one of the co-organizers. I want to thank all my several of my authors who were here today, from Women Beyond Belief, Discovering Life Without Religion. They rock. They're just awesome. And we really appreciate you coming to the first ever Atheist Festival in Portland, and it's not going to be the last. Charlie Ringel, our co-organizer, is going to close for us. And a special thanks to Peter and Paul Barquette. Awesome music.
All right, I'm going to give the closing prayer. No, only kidding. Yeah, I have to second. Peter and Paul made this whole event. Thanks so much to Karen. I think it was her inspiration. There might have been some wine involved. I'm not sure. I think it's possible. But thank you very much for coming out. And I hope that if one thing this event has done, it's just made it a little bit more likely so that when somebody starts talking to you about their religious faith, that you'll tell them about your non-belief. That you're a good, intelligent person, but gee, you're just not religious. And you know, we need to get more used to telling people that rather than trying to keep it inside of ourselves. Thank you so much. Again, Peter and Paul, thank you. And again, have a good one.